All right, welcome to another edition of Favorite Funny, and I'm your host, Carl Kozlowski, coming to you from Little Rock, Arkansas, and though I should pretend that I'm in LA and happening, but today we have our first international guest. I'm thrilled to be bringing you one of England's most talented DJs and rappers and entertainers, and he's also one of my best friends of many years. We were homies in Los Angeles in the early 2000s. And Allan has also been a semifinalist on Britain's Got Talent. Just amazing guy. Ladies and gentlemen, Allan Turner-Ward.
I'll applaud my
studio audience. Yeah. Okay. Enough of that. Yeah, so Allan, where are you at exactly in England? What area? What place?
Well, a bit like you with the Los Angeles thing. I'm actually in a place called Dorset on the south coast of England. So I'm just going to say I'm in London.
So. Yeah, you used to always introduce yourself to ladies by going, I forget what town you said you were from growing up, but you'd always say south of London.
Bournemouth. I'm from Bournemouth.
South of London. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyways. So you're in England. And you're doing the whole DJing thing and all that primarily. We're going to get to what your shows are in a little bit. But yeah, just in general, though, I think people would be fascinated to know, how is England right now culturally with the pandemic shutdowns? Because you talked to me one night last year, the last night before things got locked down. And then things have opened up again, right? But then I keep hearing different things that maybe it's back being locked down again.
Well, we've opened up and we're now just coming out of our third lockdown. So, I mean, you're right. We hadn't spoken for a couple of years, and then we suddenly both figured out we could do a Facebook video call. And I was actually at my leisure centre at my swimming pool and area, and I was like, and the bar was open, but I realised the bar wasn't going to close. I realised that 2 days later the bar was going to close probably for a very long time. So I just stayed in the bar till about 3 a.m. and you kind of stayed with me because you were on video call. So it was brilliant. But it was weird. I think, it's strange. England, I mean, I think at the beginning of lockdown, it was quite lovely in England because it was very much like the Second World War. We were all unified together, even though we had to stay apart. And we would all, every Thursday evening at 7 p.m, we would all stand outside. Did you do this in America as well, where we'd stand outside and we'd applaud all the nurses in the United Kingdom. So the whole island would applaud at 7 p.m. and applaud the whole. That lasted about 2 months. But then, of course, people started getting aggressive and people weren't up to do the applauding anymore. I think drinking's gone up big time. That's just in my flat. But anyway, but yeah, I think drinking's gone up loads in Britain. I think the crime rate's definitely gone up because the police are used to it.
And that's in your flat too.
What's that? Sorry?
I said the crime rate's gone up. That's in your flat.
Yeah, that's gone up in my flat as well. Yeah, but no, Jim, there's something about Britain that's, we've got a terrible police force in Britain. They are just, they're the politest police in the world, but the most useless. And they are just, if there's someone like maybe mixing to see their grandmother, you know, like going against the rules, they'll happily arrest them. But if there's property crime, the police don't like to be involved in the UK. It's just, unfortunately, it's always been that way. The police just aren't very good here. But they haven't got guns like the American police. You know, they're not very intimidating. So I suppose that's the problem. But I don't know. It's weird. So we had that lockdown. Then from nowhere, Bournemouth, where I come from, we've got like the nice, it's actually a beautiful place. We've got the most amazing beach. And we suddenly had a heat wave last summer. And the whole of England pretty much piled down to the beach. So none of the coffee shops were open. None of the bars were open, but everyone was crowded on the beach. And once again, the police did nothing. The police were there. I mean, the police were trying to shout on these things going, please stop sunbathing. And nobody was paying attention. And everyone carried sunbathing. But it was, it's just very strange. I think, look, there's positives and negatives, aren't there? I think the negative is the day after I spoke to you last year, I did my last proper paid gig, because I was working as a DJ all over the south of England in bars and clubs all the time. So ever since I did Britain's Got Talent, which you mentioned, I haven't stopped working. I've just worked all the time, kind of like a comic that's maybe just been on Last Comic Standing or something. I was just booked constantly to go. But then the next day, Boris Johnson, our prime minister, just said pubs are closing today. I haven't really done, I've done maybe three gigs since then. And that was hard to suddenly just be told, boom, your career has been put on hold and you have no more jobs. But then I started live streaming. And so I suppose the yin to all of that is the fact that every negative does have a positive. And I may not have focused on the live streaming the same way had I been carrying on doing the pubs and clubs the way I was doing, because I was so consistent with that. And it was such a safe kind of world of income that realistically I'm like, and I love live streaming. I just absolutely, I've fallen in love with it, but it's something I probably wouldn't have considered doing if it wasn't for lockdown. We came out of lockdown a week ago, last Monday, and now all of a sudden the pubs are open, but you can only sit in the garden. But we're in England. England's cold, so that's pointless. But, you know, so we're not allowed in a bar, but you are allowed to sit outside the bar and be served a pint. So entertainment's still not happening, but who cares? You know, we're going to, it will all unravel when it's supposed to. And I suppose the most important thing is that we do get to the bottom of this pandemic, really. That's the real fact. Isn't it? I mean, we can complain all we like, but the fact of the matter is we need to pull together in essence to stay apart and just get on with it, because we need to conquer this thing. Well, sorry, I waffled a lot there.
No, that's cool. We'll get to the point of the show, which is getting people to share their favorite funny life stories and favorite funny books and movies and TV shows. But before we get into that, we still should get across how people can see you and listen to you. You're on the radio with the Allan Turner-Ward Show at what days, and where can people find it?
Well, it's on show. So the United Kingdom time, I'm on tonight actually, but it's Tuesday. So Tuesday, 7 p.m. until 9 p.m. on Tuesdays. I'm on a station called 90.1 Hope FM. It's actually a Christian gospel inspirational station, but I play lots of secular stuff as well. They allow me to just, the deal when I went back to them was that I was going to be able to play feel good music from all eras and genres. And I also then syndicate the show out. So the show goes out to Sapphire Radio in Cyprus on Saturdays, Epic Radio on Mondays, that's in Vancouver. And then also an urban station called State of the Art, which is weird because I'm the most unurban person that is in the world, but they love it. And they tend to play my show. So, and it also goes out as a podcast. So that's really cool. But yeah, 90.1 Hope FM. It's, I'd like you to come on there sometime, Carl. I'd really love to. Absolutely. Just give you, yeah, that'd be brilliant. And we can promote this.
Yeah. And then you live stream on Twitch at 9 PM Wednesdays, Fridays, and Saturdays with the Allan Turner Ward Feel Good live stream.
Exactly. Yeah, the ATW Feel Good live stream. Yeah. So yeah, please awesome. Come and join.
Okay.
Twitch TV. Yeah. It's a whole new exciting medium, as it were. It's funny because when I lived in LA and we used to hang out, the thing of live streaming was just so uneven thought of, wasn't it? It's like something like, it's kind of like when we were in the 80s and our parents talked about, oh, the wonderful day when you'll have colored television. But it's like us in 2004 in LA, we couldn't have even remotely thought about the world of live streaming. It just didn't exist, did it? It was just such a...
No.
So the medium of television and entertainment is just changing so much. It's really exciting.
Yeah, I think so. Well, let's skip into some of your life stories, especially from your time in LA, which, like, what years were you in LA? Like around 2000 to 2008, right? Something like that?
Yeah, I think it was 2000. I was in, 2000, I worked in Greece and Mallorca. That was actually the year that I did Shake the Knee. So that was 2001. Then I was on tour. 2003. Yeah, I was on the cruise ships working and I left the cruise ships and then went to LA and decided to try and make my dreams come true.
Like Laverne and Shirley. Do you know that theme song, Laverne and Shirley?
No, what's that? No,
oh my God. I'll have to, everybody, if you don't know Laverne and Shirley, it's the greatest theme song of all time. I'll look it up on, I'll send it to you later, Alan. But anyway.
Right. Yeah, please.
But it's a TV theme song, and it was from a sitcom in the 70s, and the whole, it's like a really singable song, And they go, we're gonna make our dreams come true, doing it our way. And it's totally like, we were like the male Laverne and Shirley, you'll see. Anyway, Laverne and Shirley always were, they were always, they were two working class girls that were always getting themselves into adventures, chasing their dreams.
Right.
Okay. I don't know if you were Laverne and I was Shirley or the opposite, but we were very, very much like that. So that was anyway,
us driving around LA in the worst cars that I've ever seen that would just make the noises that you didn't know cars could even make. I'm actually a really good mechanic now because I've had such terrible cars in Los Angeles. Because do you remember, I just learned how to kick a car and it would start. It was just like, I became so good at dealing with crap cars. It was brilliant.
Well, yeah, but as Ferris Bueller says about Cameron, at least you have a piece of crap car.
Yeah.
You know, no,
so true.
Yeah. But anyway, so...
in the first 6 months... Sorry, cut you off.
So you were living in L.A. and you managed to book two unusual jobs at the same time. You were DJing in a strip club called the Seventh Veil. And you were also DJing at Walt Disney, Disneyland family parties. So tell us about the time you managed to mix those two gigs up regarding Pocahontas.
Yeah, you probably didn't know the story at the time because I kind of gave up my strip club job because I felt it wasn't right in my faith and so forth. Because I radical. Yeah, well, no, really. Was it really wrong?
You mean didn't want you at the strip club? Yeah.
The Lord didn't want to see me. I wasn't going to. No, I won't carry that on. It was weird because I do remember, though, I just walked in. It's one of those, from a law of attraction angle, though, I do remember just so well saying, right, I think I'm going to get a job at the strip club. I could do that. I wasn't really even a DJ at the time. And then I managed to land a job as an MC over at Disney. Over in Anaheim. So I was doing these weddings. So you probably remember that bit, but I would be.
Yeah.
I remember I welcomed a girl on stage called Pocahontas. And my favorite gag was always like, hey fellas, I bet you'd like to Pocahontas. and of course, any man that is in a strip club is going to laugh at that because he's not going to, but you don't really say that again when you're doing a wedding and at the actual Pocahontas at Disney actually walks out. So yeah, that did happen. And so I would sometimes forget which gig I was actually at. You're just in the zone of playing music and talking to the crowd and making friends with everybody. And the way I see it, every gig I'm doing is pretty much the same. You know, it's always the same. You're just giving your best that you can do. They're not all strip clubs. They're all gigs. Every gig you're doing, you should do is if you're doing your last gig ever, but sometimes you might forget which one you're doing. So I was at Disney after a long night at the Seventh Veil and then seeing the real Pocahontas. Well, she wasn't the real Pocahontas, but then saying the same joke. Hey, fellas, I bet you'd like to Pocahontas. And then I'm looking at children around me going, what's he mean? And then dad's going. So, yeah, that was interesting.
Okay, so then taking people through a little bit of your prior career, you, as you mentioned, in 2001, came up with a song that was quite popular in Europe called Shake the Knees. Folks, just I highly recommend Google or YouTube, actually YouTube, Allan Turner-Ward, like it sounds, Shake the Knees, and you'll see what all the fuss is about. Great song, loads of fun. And you managed to, years later, when you appeared on Britain's Got Talent, I understand that Simon Cowell kind of in a shady way asked you if you would do Shake the Knees as your song when you really wanted to do something else. So what happened on Britain's Got Talent with the song?
Well, on the song, this was bizarre with Britain's Got Talent because I went on there three times. So the first two times I never got past the T-boy. I don't know. Did you ever? I know you do comedy. Have you ever auditioned for Last Comic Standing or any of those things?
Once ever, you know, and it was weird when I went, but it's a whole other story. Yeah.
But usually there's just literally one person behind a table that's probably, I don't know, you know, a PA or something like that. And they've got the right to say whether they think you're good enough to go to the next level. The first two times I went on Britain's Got Talent wasn't long after I left America, and I didn't even get past the PA. I didn't get past the whatever because it was I tried to do some serious music, And then I went on and I decided to do a song called Model Pose, which did actually go to number 4 on iTunes. But it was weird with Model Pose because it was a silly song as well. There really are silly, fun tunes, same way Shape the Knees was. But I remember I did Model Pose, I got through, and then I got through another stage. Then I worked through another stage, and I'm like, how am I getting through all these steps? This is brilliant. And then I got to the semifinals, and the producers were hounding me, going, Simon really wants you to do Shape the Knees. And I'm like, I don't think so. He said I'm the cheesiest thing he's ever seen. He said I'm the worst thing he's ever seen in his life. Why would he say he wants to? And they went, seriously, Allan, he really wants you to do Shape the Knees. Now, I'd remixed an old song by the Rolling Stones called Get Off My Cloud. You can see that on YouTube. And I thought that was a great tune. And I thought, but it's, you know, it's kind of quite credible, really. It's quite a credible tune. And I'm beatboxing on it and I'm scratching and all that stuff. They went, no, 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 do Shake the Knees. And I thought, well, you know what? If they're going on and on about it. And they gave me another producer, this brilliant producer. And we went ahead and did it. And I actually at the time thought it was a massive failure because I just thought, well, I didn't get through to the finals. And, you know, I saw Simon Cowell. He winks at me when I'm actually on the stage because normal people will come out of the curtain. But because I was behind a DJ booth, I had to go up there before the thing starts. So my whole video footage is playing on the side. Simon winks at me and says, we're going to have some fun with you now, Allan. And then he turns to the other three judges and says, right, you loved him last time, you don't like him this time. You quite like him and you love him. And they literally did exactly as he told them to do, which I thought was fascinating. Mm-hmm. And I can only say I admire Simon for having that leadership skill. And I thought at that point, okay, I've clearly been had a little bit here, but I'm going to enjoy this. So I knew that's, if you watch it back, you'll see a bit where I even go, I don't even care what Simon says, I'm coming down. And I jump off the stage and I get on with it. And I just thought, oh, I'm going to just enjoy this. But it is funny. But the funny thing is, I mean, I thought Simon didn't really like me. And then he actually said I fascinated him and all this stuff on the stage. But then he also sent me a very beautiful woman to my dressing room afterwards. And she said, Simon's told me to tell you how he thinks you're really charismatic and you're going to do really well. And here's a number for a radio station. And, you know, he really likes you. And the annoying thing is that woman brought her boyfriend with her. that was the only annoying thing about that situation. But yeah, the song went to number 1 on iTunes the next week, wow. Which was really weird. It was in and out. I mean, in and out like that. But
yeah,
how do you make God laugh? Tell him your plans. I'd had no plans on releasing that song at all.
You know, that it kind of reminds me of how in Love Actually, that crazy old singer who you remind me of, how he has like the song that nobody expects to rise to the top of the charts, and he winds up at the top of the charts. It reminds me of that. So you're like a real life him, anyway.
Yeah, he sounds, doesn't he? This is shit, isn't it? Oh, solid gold shit, my friend.
yep. So
it's shit, but it's solid gold shit.
It was. It is. Yeah. I don't think it's shit though. So then in England, in LA, you said that you have lots of other good memories, but there was one encounter that was especially meaningful, and it was with Uncle Frank. He was Jimmy Kimmel's literal uncle, but Jimmy Kimmel's American late night talk show host, and he hired his uncle to pretend to be security for the show. And yeah. I think I was with you when we ran into him on the street, wasn't I? Yeah.
Yeah, and there was a girl called Lauren with us as well. Lovely black, really nice girl.
Okay.
Yeah, Lauren, I think she worked as a journalist. I don't know. Anyway, but either way, he just stopped us. I think maybe you spotted him. But he had these eyes.
Yeah. I would jump on anybody that was remotely famous, yeah.
I know. I was with you.
I'm a whore. Yeah.
Where you did. I'll never forget with who's there? Oh man, who's the who's there was a comedian from Canada who's Indian.
Russell Peters.
Russell Peters. Now I'm working with a DJ that is Russell Peters' DJ. He's called Stein from Scratch, if you want to interview him. But he's been on tour all over the world with Russell Peters. But I was telling him the story how Russell Peters knew that I was a DJ in the crowd because you told him. You said, oh, this is DJ Allan Turner-Ward. And he said, I've never heard of you. But then he came outside after the gig just to meet me, just to find out who I was and what I'd done. And then he was telling about his DJ. And then you just jumped on it. Like, am I allowed to swear on here a little bit or not?
Yeah, sure. Hello. Go ahead.
Yeah, but I remember you were talking so much at him that he went, man, you just ejaculated in my face with your mouth.
Oh, my God. Wow.
Because well, your friend just ejaculated on you because you were so excited to talk to him. But anyway,
that was a euphemism. I did not actually do that, folks, just so you know. Anyway.
He didn't ejaculate on his mouth. He ejaculated from his mouth to his mouth, meaning he spat. Yes, that was it. Basically, he was spitting. Yeah. I didn't really get it at the time. I was like, Russell, that's lovely. Anyway.
Okay, but, so tell me about Uncle Frank. Please stop humiliating me with the Russell Peters story.
Sorry. You make it a bit easy, though. That's sometimes. All right. But yeah, it's Russell Peters. No, forget Russell Peters. But don't forget, go and see him. With Uncle Frank, it was lovely because we saw him on the street. I think we were wherever the tube stop is.
Yeah, there was a tube North Hollywood.
Stop, North Hollywood. And he used to take the tube, didn't he? He used to take the subway. Yeah. That was really lovely. But I remember it was actually the second time I'd met him, but I'd met him once a few years before. But he just looked at me and I don't know. It was almost like he knew that I was going through something because it was a few days before I had to leave America. I was clearly in a massive load of confusion of where I was going. I'd been there for 5.5 years. And he just put his hand on my shoulder and just looked me in the eyes and said, you're going to make it. You're going to make it. You know, exactly the same character that was on the show, but it was so sincere and kind. And just when you're going to make it, I can tell you've got the personality. You're going to do it. I can tell. And I was like, oh, wow. Thank you very much. That's really kind. But I needed to hear that at the time because it was a time where LA, although I love my memories of LA, they were also quite sad because if I'm honest, I'd never felt as much of a failure as when you do 5.5 years of hustling in Los Angeles, you know, and you think, oh, God, I should have got so much further, or I should have, you know, and then you see people that you do know that went off and really cracked it. And then he said, oh, gosh, I should have done more. But it was so kind that he said that. And it's amazing how words of encouragement can just do that. Mind you, do you know what's funny about you? When he did that, he put his hand and he was having a real moment with me, clearly knew that I was going through a bad time. And he went, you're going to do it. I can tell you got a great personality. You're going to do it. And then you just dived in and went, what about me? Am I going to do it as well?
Hey, look, what's important? Me finding out. No, I don't know. Anyway, all right. Sorry, Brains. Wow. Well, at least you had your moment with him. But so tell me another thing that made you noteworthy in England was you had some fun with the Dave Clark Fives, Mad All Over, or Glad All Over. Because what you specialized in doing was for a time, you were taking old rock hits and you were adding raps to them, with the chorus being the famous, like, glad all over, yes, yeah. I'm glad all over. And with the Rolling Stones, like, Get Off My Cloud, that was probably the chorus. So
yeah,
people can still find this on YouTube as well, right? Allan Turner-Ward,
yeah.
Glad All Over. Okay.
Actually, Dave Clark turned a bit vicious because he got all funny because I put it in the paper that I was going to work with him. And then he managed to get it taken down on YouTube. And the only version I've got on YouTube, there is a version on YouTube, but it's quite... it's not that good. If I'm on it, it's kind of recorded off a phone onto my phone, but it's still good. I mean, you still see the quote. I mean, he loved it though. I mean, the actual Dave Clark got in touch with me when he saw it. And I remember he phoned me. I was engaged to an American lady at the time. And she didn't understand that I wasn't really allowed in America at the time. And she said, I was going back to America and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, boring. That bit's boring. But, I remember he said, oh, you've got to come to my place for tea. You've got to come to my place for tea. So I went up to London and he had the most amazing house. But you've got to realize Dave Clark from the Dave Clark Five, not only did he own the copyright of the Dave Clark Five, he owned the copyright of every musical thing that happened on British television, on Ready, Steady, Go and Top of the Pops. He made more money than all the Beatles alone. I mean, he is worth so much money. And I must admit, on one side, I was really inspired by him, but the other side, he was so consumed with what he'd earned that it was almost like he couldn't enjoy the art so much, if that makes sense. I know it's weird. Yeah. He was so consumed by the business and the technical sides and the copyright and all this stuff, and that he couldn't just enjoy a good tune, which you kind of get the feeling Paul McCartney would. Paul McCartney would just go, I don't care, I just want to play music. I just want to play the music. I want to earn my money, but play the music. But you get the feeling with him, the business side had actually corrupted his artistic spirit a little bit, which might sound a bit pretentious, but either way, he invited me to London, and it was a pleasure to meet him because I do consider him a massive, massive legend, because he's very much what Simon Cowell is, really. He's got that whole business aspect where he's just got ties in everything. But yeah, he saw it. He invited me to London, and then I met Elton John, somebody to do with Elton John, Elton John's best friend or whatever. He came over. But it was just so interesting. Do you know what I found most interesting? And I don't know whether you can relate to this. And I watch a lot of Seinfeld's comedians in cars getting coffee. And the psycho, when you are a comic or you're an entertainer or you're a DJ or you're an actor or something, the one thing is you sort of speak this language a bit like lawyers probably speak their own language, or doctors, you speak the same language, or people in fashion. And it's like, when to sit with him and think how much money he had and how wealthy he was, when we broke all that away, all we were two creatives just having a conversation. And it was a really honest, once we broke away from all the bullshit, there was actually a really honest, brilliant, creative conversation going on, which I was incredibly inspired by. But yeah, not necessarily that funny though. It's not a funny story. Not really funny. The only thing that was funny is when he got my lyrics, he goes, can I have your lyrics then? Your rap lyrics, can I have them? Can I have them? And I went, and he was like Mr. Burns from The Simpsons. He was like, can I have them? Can I have them though? And I was like, yeah, I'll go on then. Useless businessman. And I gave him my lyrics that I'd written, and then it was time for me to go. So I'd been there for 3 hours. He'd got hold of my lyrics and he was just holding them like this. Go on then, goodbye. Go on, goodbye. Go on, goodbye then. So that was quite interesting. So do you know another memory I've got? Do you remember that we went to meet John Travolta?
Oh, that's right. Yeah, that was okay. So I'll hear your remembrance of that as well. But my remembrance, that was a very funny experience because he was appearing at the Aero Theater in Santa Monica for the American Cinematheque. And it was a screening of Hairspray, which is an absolutely brilliant movie. And anyways, he was doing a career Q&A about his career. And when it was over, I think, I had volunteered because I was a volunteer at the Cinematheque screenings in Hollywood. And I believe, wasn't I one of the security people that night, or did I just assault him while other people were security guards? Because I remember following him out the back of the theater to his car. I think I was, I don't mean literally assaulted, but I'm saying I was, if I want to meet somebody, I will push through, step on, do whatever to meet the person. And I can't remember if I was one of the guards that night or if I was just in the crowd. I think I was a guard.
Well, I went big. I think we were in the front row on the left.
Okay.
Of the front row. And I remember him arriving. The first thing I remember is that he was an absolute gentleman.
Oh, yeah, totally.
And everybody basically told him how wonderful he was for most of the evening, until you came along and asked a question. And then you basically asked him this question. You said, you started off with, you're one of my favorite actors. So he was like, you know, he got the get that bit going on. And then you said, but why do you make like a bad movie and then a really good movie and then a really bad movie again? And then you go and make a good movie. And why do you do that? And he was generally stumped, because there is no doubt John Travolta is one of those characters that has made, he makes Grease and Saturday Night Fever, and then he does a few years of making these nonsense movies, doesn't he, that do nothing at the box office. And then he comes back with Look Who's Talking, and then he's gone again.
The Pulp Fiction, and then...
Yeah.
He has more ups and downs than probably anybody in movie history.
It's so weird. It's so weird. Like, because I remember that you pointed out about that he was a pilot and stuff like that. And but what was fascinating with him was that he actually answered it really well. He said he considers himself like a jazz musician, that he wants to go off over here for a while, but then come back to the mainstream, but then go off and try new things. And whether that's actually the truth, we don't know. But it's actually a brilliant answer that he said. And then I don't know whether you noticed. Then he was checking me out and he said, are you the guy from Germany? And I went, no, I actually am German. I'm half German. But he said, are you the guy from Germany? And I said, no, I'm from England. He goes, oh, I thought you were the guy from Germany. Because in Germany, Scientology is banned. And there was a German guy at the Q&A. But he literally picked me out of everybody. He looked at me and went, are you the guy? I said, no, not me, no. But he was lovely. I do remember just thinking, what a nice, let that be an example. If you ever make it huge, I mean, he is just such a gentleman kind of character, you know?
Well, it's funny that you brought up, I forgot about what I had asked him, but I remember now. And I do have a reputation, but it usually worked to my advantage that I will give you a question that nobody else is going to give you. And a lot of stars, like I know one in particular who likes me is Colin Farrell. He actually, when I was doing more of these events, going to the press days, I would always be approved for the best seat next to him at the table. And he would always call on me first because he was, you know, even though the question wasn't an easy question, it didn't always kiss their ass. Like just that whole thing, I called him out. Like, why are you making crap? Why do you have to keep having comebacks over and over instead of, if you know how to make a good movie, keep making good ones, you know? But Colin, it's the same way. People were asking him stupid questions like, oh, have you ever been to the city that you filmed the movie in before? Did you like it? Would you go there on vacation again? And I'm asking him deep questions about the meaning of his movie, you know? And anyway, so I take pride in that. But let me...
Just cut you off there. I actually think I've said, and so many other people in LA that knew you said, you know, strip everything away. That is your genius. That's why you are the funniest journalist in America. You got voted it for a reason. You are...
Thank you.
Really, yeah, but you're a really, really good journalist. And that's why I've always said to you, stop messing around with the other stuff. Just strip it back and do straight up Carl Kozlowski interviews like we're doing now and put them straight on YouTube. Yeah. You don't need all the extra BS because you've got what it takes. And it's, I think if someone like Colin Farrell, who let's be honest, is probably one of those awkward people in Hollywood. If he wants to be, he can be horrible, can't he? He can be quite a little badass.
I've heard that, but like I said, my experience with him has been nothing but great over and over.
Because you've challenged him though, and he respects you. He probably respects you because you're not. I remember, are we allowed to bring up? I remember when you said something about Dane Cook, and really, Dane was your friend, and all you said was the truth. He wasn't that great. Well, he wasn't. The fact is, as a stand up, Dane Cook was probably one of my biggest inspirations, but as an actor,
I
want
to ask about that.
He was a bit. All right, cheers, mate. You know, it is. And
wait,
I remember
I looked at him like nothing. I worshipped him as a stand-up.
I know.
I loved him as a stand-up. No, the only where I ran afoul of him was that I saw a movie he did called Dan in Real Life, and I thought he was brilliant in it. And I did something that in my head still to this day makes logical sense, but he took it as a huge offense. So what it was I saw the movie early because I went to a lot of test screenings back then. Like in Los Angeles and New York, they'll show a movie months ahead of time and get audience reactions so they know how to adjust the movie to make it more commercial. So I went to an early screening, thought the movie was brilliant. I thought it was an Oscar contender even, which it was not ultimately. It did not get nominated for Oscars, but I thought this movie is that good that it deserves to be up for a bunch of Oscars. And I came home and I wrote Dane and said, hey, because I had his email, we would correspond. We were close enough to email each other. And I said, hey, congrats. Your movie's amazing. You're great in it. And he was like, oh, thanks, man. And I said, when the movie comes out, let me do a cover story on you for my newspaper. And he was like, of course. I'm like, and I was like, seriously, do not let the LA Times or LA Weekly do this. Let me have it for LA City Beat. And he was like, you got it, brother. You got it. And so then I went on IMDb and I found the movie, and I usually would comment on IMDb under a pseudonym, a fake name. I use Bueller to fake when I make comments about Hollywood on different websites. But this one time I forgot to say Bueller and I used my own name, And I said about the movie, I gave it 10 stars out of 10. I said, this is deserves to be up for Best Picture. And I said, Dane Cook's in it. And I said, even though he's in over his head early in the movie, by the end, he's stealing the show with some of the best scenes. And I was just A, being honest, because I always am honest, even if it hurts me. And B, I thought it was a good tactic to do that because he was so big at the time that there was massive backlash. People were going, oh, he sucks just because he was famous. And so I thought, if I just say he's great, period, nobody's going to take the comment seriously. I thought I was actually being helpful by saying, okay, early on, he's not that great, but he gets better as the movie goes on. He went looking for the comments because I told him about the screening. So he probably went looking to see what other people had to say. And then he stumbled across my comment and he was furious. And he said, you know, I'll have you know, I've been acting for years and we shot the scenes that you think are weaker. We shot those last. I shot the scenes that you like the best first. And I was like, and he kept yelling at me in this email and or in a chat. And I finally just was like, so you're saying you got worse as the movie went on? And he hasn't talked to me since. It's been 15 years. So
you actually paid to go and see his comeback, and he didn't even know that you might have been in the audience, that you'd actually paid money to go and see his comeback.
This was an early test screening. But then in 2019, I went to see his comedy tour. Yeah, I went because I still like the guy.
All that happened. You couldn't have loved him any more than you did. I think the only thing I'd say in his defense is I think at that point he'd lost both of his parents in 1 year.
Yeah, sure. That was a couple of years before that, though, before he lost them.
Oh, was it? But I think also...
Yeah, but you know, in his defense, there is a defense for him. He was dealing with a lot of backlash and a lot of people, you know, who were attacking him solely for being popular. And he can't help that he's popular. It's a gift. It's a miracle. You know, he was more popular than any comedian since Steve Martin. That's a fact. He was the first comedy album to make the top 10 in America in like 35 years and or 25 or 30 years, something like that. And, you know, so there was this huge backlash because there's always people that will say, oh, he's so big, what a sellout. And instead, he's so big because he's brilliant.
Him at Dublin's. I went by myself. It was like my first week or two in LA. And I must admit, I was trying to do stand-up at the time. And I must admit, it made me realize I'm good at DJing. I'm good at music. I really shouldn't even bother going in the ring with somebody like that because he was so good. It was just like, there were so many other great comedians that were on as well, like Darren Carter, Jay Davies, and that tall black guy, I've forgotten his name, Alonzo. There were loads of really good ones who have since gone and made it. Do you remember there was that that one guy that's really done well, who's on, who was always at Dublin's? Who's, he was even on Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee.
I don't know, sorry.
I'll remember, he's Italian. A really good looking.
Sebastian Maniscalco.
Bingo. And I used to see him every week. But I tell you what, Dane Cook, he was in the shade of Dane at the time. It was the same time, but Dane was the guy that everybody came to see, wasn't he? He wasn't playing that. But like, it's no point in going tonight.
We saw Dane he was big at Dublin's, and Dublin's was this epic, it was a restaurant that had a huge space where they could do shows. And Jay Davis was just starting out as a producer then. And he went on to become the biggest promoter in all of LA comedy, I'd say, for several years. He ran the hottest show in town at the Laugh Factory. But at Dublin's, they were all just starting out, and Dane was his best friend. And this is probably when we saw him first. It was about a year or two before he exploded. So we were there, and that's how I got in with Dane, was that because I liked him so much before he was really famous. I did a story on him, and I was the first journalist outside of his hometown of Boston to ever write about him. And
really?
So for about 2 years, I was gold with him. I was able to hang out with him at restaurants. He would run off stage and high five me in the crowd, make me look like a badass, you know. And then I upset him with the movie thing, and he did come over, I'd say about 2 years later in 2008 at the Laugh Factory Christmas party. he sat down for a minute and said, hey, you know, I'm sorry I've been so upset. I forgive you. We're cool. But then we've never had a conversation ever since. So, you know, how much that counts.
Huh? I think he's going through his own stuff. But I mean, all I'm saying is I've never been, that actually is one of your questions anyway, isn't it? I think, but I mean,
yeah, what did you find so inspiring about him? I was going to ask that.
Well, do you know, I mean, I'm getting back to that time at Dublin's. This is actually long before I even knew you. So it was about a good year and a half before I met you. So I came to LA in 2003. So I saw him around that time. And I just remember thinking it was like watching, like I'm massive. One thing I love to watch is great showmen. There are some great showmen in entertainment. I think Steve Martin was a great showman, wasn't he? Yes. He knew how to do it. But realistically, you watch Freddie Mercury, you watch Mick Jagger. But Dane Cook had that in comedy. And it's like, oh, the way he could just manipulate a crowd with his, I don't even know if he knew what he was doing, but his handwork and everything, the NLP of it, it was like Hitler. Hitler had that same thing. And I don't mean that in a, Hitler was the worst human being ever in the world. But the way he could work a crowd was amazing. The way he could just lift it, kind of Churchill.
So basically, the headline from this interview is going to be Dane Cook. He's as good as Hitler.
He wishes. Yeah.
I'm sure he really wants that compliment. Anyways, I got to.
You know, if someone said that to me, I'd find that, I'd be like, oh, thanks, man. But I get the feeling he would actually take, he wouldn't get the irony in that. So please don't put that at all.
No, I know.
It would have been nice. I would have loved to see Dane in his prime come to Europe, though, because I think the Europeans and the Australians would have absolutely loved him.
He did travel around the world. I know for a fact he did very well in Australia.
He didn't really, though. He never went on American, on British television or...
Okay, Australia. I don't know. I know he was in Australia.
But it was the way... I suppose this is what it is. When I saw him at Dublin's, I've never, ever been so in tune to a comic. I've never been there that I'm listening like almost like it's music. And also the way in which there was no, you wouldn't even hear a glass go, you know, it was like you wouldn't hear anything. Now, with getting to Sebastian, who I do really like as well, and lots of the others, yeah, they were into it, but people were walking around still and people sitting down. But the moment Dane came on, and this is before he blew up, it was just like pure silence because they were just listening to every single word he said. And the way his hands flapped around, and it was just, it was so powerful. It was just so powerful. So,
yeah. Okay, well, I only have a couple more minutes. So, your favorite book, funny book, is The Secret Diary of Adrian Mole. I haven't heard of this one. Why is it your favorite?
Well, I haven't read many books.
There's that. Yeah.
But no, if I read books, it's usually autobiographies. But they're not usually that funny. They're life stories, aren't they? And yeah. The Secret Diary of Adrian Mole was actually a TV show in Britain about a teenager that was massively uncool, that had spots, and he would write about how he was trying to get birds and get women. And, you know, he was trying to learn to roller skate to turn cool, and he would always fall over. And then he tried to pierce his own ear. It was the time when earrings were in. And he would get blood all over the place. It was, it was very, very funny. Same time as The Young Ones. Have you heard of The Young Ones?
Heard of it.
It was just coming out of the punk era in the 80s. But it was, if you read it, it is so, I think you would get it. I'm not certain it would transcend to America that well, but I think you would get it.
Okay. And your favorite funny movie, this is one I do know, The Interview. I just ordered the poster. I'm getting ready to move into my own place and I want to get some more art. And the poster's awesome, but The Interview, that's the movie with Seth Rogen, James Franco. And it was notorious because they go to North Korea and they have the real dictator, Kim Jong-un, portrayed by an actor. But they go there as American journalists for an interview and they get asked by the CIA to kill Kim Jong-un while they're there. And the movie was controversial because Sony Pictures was supposed to put it out and North Korea threatened terrorist acts if Sony released it. And so I had to see it. Like, you were in England probably when it came out, but when I saw it, they were playing it only at an independent movie theater in Westwood called the Westwood Crest. And the big chain theaters, they were terrified to show it. They didn't carry it. So the movie was something that only became popular on video really in America because most theaters were afraid to carry it. They really thought there was going to be North Korean soldiers showing up and killing people. It was ridiculous. But that's anyway,
Wow. I didn't know that. Oh, I wondered why I try and bring it up to people because it came out on Netflix. And there's obviously that bit where Eminem comes out as a gay, doesn't he? And comes out as a gay.
Yeah.
Which is funny. That bit is funny, but it's actually nothing compared to how funny some of the other bits of the movie are. I mean, it's even the base. I thought Franco was amazing, actually, by the way.
Yeah.
I didn't even know Franco was funny. I didn't even know that. And I'm like, he's really, really, he's so funny. Even now, just thinking of it, it's like, yeah, I'm not. I might just give him something with my hands. It was like explosions. Are you honey dicking?
I just remember that when the movie was out, it was quite daring for Sony to have made it, and so I told my folks who are my dad left Poland, which was communist like North Korea. And I said, oh, you're going to love this movie. Go see it. Support it because it's very much against North Korea. And that I wasn't thinking, oh, it's also extremely R-rated with loads of dirty jokes.
Yeah, exactly. I do history tours with my father. And we went out to Auschwitz in Poland, which was fascinating. I've got a YouTube video on it. Uh-huh. And it's like, but my dad is obsessed with the Second World War and upset. We went to the trenches in the First World War as well. But I thought, and he's obsessed with the Korean stuff as well. But I tried to play in the interview, but he never got past 10 minutes because he couldn't handle all the swearing. And he goes, this is disgusting. I'm like, oh, just wait. It gets funny. But I think that's the biggest problem with that movie is it takes too long maybe to get going if you don't want to offend too many people. But you know what, it doesn't matter. I love it. It's my favorite movie.
I just remember I told my folks to go and they went because it came out on Christmas Day, and in Little Rock they showed it because nobody you know was scared that North Korea would waste their time attacking Little Rock, and they went and they were terribly offended, which I can't say I blame them. I felt stupid afterwards. But then your favorite,
it's quite kind of hilarious. Having met your father, that is actually hilarious that you sent him to go see it.
Well, so lastly, the last thing I want to ask you about is your favorite funny TV show. You said it's probably Cheers.
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple in England that you wouldn't know about, Gavin and Stacey, which is actually, you have heard of it.
Yeah,
well, it's James Corden's show. That's how James Corden landed. James Corden was not... James Corden was trying to make it for a while in the UK as an actor. And then he was actually offered... I don't know whether you know this story about him, but he was offered quite like 90,000 a year to be in a soap opera. And he said his gut told him not to. So he just didn't. He didn't do it when they had no money, but his parents were in the Salvation Army. And his parents prayed with him and they said, well, look, if your gut's saying no, then just don't do it. So he went and then he wrote Gavin and Stacey. So he actually created Gavin and Stacey. And if you watch it, it is hilarious. That's actually where Carpool Karaoke even came from. I posted something on Facebook where it's the first ever Carpool and Karaoke. And he's playing the role that he played called Smitty. That he played in Gavin and Stacey. I love that show, but I don't think it does transcend that well to America because it's showing the difference between Wales and Scotland and different parts of England. Whereas I think a lot of the time the Americans just see this is England. They don't really notice that there's, and I'd say this not to belittle Americans' view, it's just we're such a small country, but with so many different accents and different things going on in different regions. And I don't think, you have to really pay attention to get it, you know, whereas something like Cheers, I say Cheers because I think it still has stood the test of time. You watch Cheers and it's still brilliantly written, isn't it? It's like every character is the casting is sensational. Cheers. The location is perfect and everything about, Sam Malone's still the coolest guy in the world when you watch it. And it's just like, wow, this is really a good show still. It's not aged. Have you watched any recently?
Not Cheers, no, not in a while. Because it's not really shown much.
What's your favorite?
My favorite sitcom? The American Office. You tried to get me to turn on to the British Office, but yeah. I need to give it another chance. But back when you were trying to show it to me, it's when I was narcoleptic, and I would have such a hard time concentrating on the accents, I would just pass out asleep. So,
worse a time with Gavin and Stacey. That's a perfect example of what I mean. It was brilliant for people from Britain, but really for people to get it over there, I get it. They would just be like, don't know why that's funny. I don't know why that's funny, you know? Whereas to us, it's funny because we've seen it all our lives, the differences. But whereas the differences with American culture, the whole world knows about American culture. Whereas if you go to Europe, French, German, British, Irish, and whatever, they've all got their own little cultures that haven't necessarily spread around the world. So,
my favorite show, I would have to say, is Saturday Night Live. And I still, I never think, like some people go, oh, it sucks now. I mean, people say that every time there's a new cast every few years. And I have thought, I've watched it since like Eddie Murphy's days. I missed the first cast with Chevy Chase and all them. I caught it in reruns. But I think there's been very few seasons, maybe two, that were just awful. And I'd say most have at least some brilliant episodes, and sometimes all of them. This season has had a couple of absolutely atrocious episodes where they should be ashamed to be getting paid for it. But then just when I'm about to give up, they did five or six in a row that were fantastic the whole way through. So
is that Andy Samberg? Is he the one
he left a few years ago. He's been on a sitcom called Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
That's a brilliant show. That's another one of my favorites.
Yeah.
That's my favorite news show. Let's put it that way. I'd say Brooklyn Nine-Nine and then Cheers. I'd say those two are my favorites.
Do they show Saturday Night Live in England?
No. But look, things are changing because all of a sudden we've got YouTube clips and stuff like that, don't we? So, I mean, Carpool Karaoke from James Corden is huge around the world because it's just a brilliant YouTube segment. So it's gone. And same with Jimmy Fallon. He's managed to cleverly just cut bits of his show together so that it works around the world, really. I think Jimmy Kimmel a little bit does that, but no, Saturday Night Live isn't. I mean, Dick in a Box did. That traveled, but not really that much. Not that much. No. Saturday Night Live is. It's a bit like the Man Show. I mean, I'm working with this guy called Chuck Gordon. I don't know if you're interested in interviewing him, but he's like one of the top stuntmen in Hollywood, and he lives now in the Netherlands, but he's just created a movie. But he's been Val Kilmer's double for years. But he was telling me that, oh, man, I want to create a show in England a bit like the Man Show and a bit like Saturday Night Live. And I said, the problem is that Brits just won't get it. You know, it's just, I love it, personally. I love American culture. But I think that's just a bit too American for Britain, you know? There's some American stuff like Cheers and Brooklyn thing that do travel. But for some reason, I don't know why, but Ben Stiller always traveled well. But Adam Sandler doesn't travel well, which I don't understand, you know? Because I love Adam Sandler. Have you met Adam Sandler?
Do I what?
Have you met Adam Sandler?
No, I haven't. Although... I'm friendly with one of his side actors, a guy named Alan Covert. He's been a podcast guest. But anyway, I'm running out of time. So remind people, how do people find your shows? When are you on again?
So I'm on 90.1 Hope FM on Tuesday nights between 7 and 9 p.m.
In
UK time, And then UK time, 9 p.m. Wednesday, Friday and Saturday. I'm live streaming on Wednesday, Friday, Saturday, 9 p.m. UK time. I'm live streaming Feel Good Music with chat and interaction and Feel Good Music from all eras and genres on Twitch TV. It was originally for gamers, but they're now opening it to like talk shows and DJs and so forth. So thank you very much.
And just so people know, UK time is 5 hours ahead of the East Coast in the US. So that's 6 hours ahead of Central, 7 hours ahead of Mountain, and 8 hours ahead of LA and the West Coast.
Mountain, I like that. Mountain, that's good. I've never heard
The Mountain's a very small part of America. But anyway, Where are you? I'm in Central.
You're Central, okay.
Yeah, 6 hours behind you. But anyways, Allan, thank you for taking the time to be on. And you know, as always, it's been a pleasure. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching Favorite Funny. Make sure you subscribe and check out our other great episodes. Until next time, I'm Carl Kozlowski. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Come on.
Are you still there?
Oh, there he goes.